Inventing Europe, the European Digital Museum for Science and Technology, has a specific identity, a specific content strategy, we might call it. It's an invitation to explore European history. The question is, of course, in what sense is it new? Is it the new European history, or is it similar to the ones we have? Well, the idea is there is a new type of European history to explore, and this type of history focuses less on the nation states and focuses less on the EU, but focuses on networks, connections, linkages, circulations. There are two lenses we apply, two specific lenses. One is about technology, the lens of technology, and the second is the lens of transnational history. And applying both lenses implies that we get a new sense, a new view on European history. But this is also an open view, as you will see, because you are all invited to join. Because there is the option on at the website, My Europe it's called, to create your own Europe, which is fits perfectly well with the intent of this website. But let me first look at the two lenses. First, the lens of technology. Because when people talk about technology, they often think about hardware, about products, machines. And this is certainly a very important part of technology, because in many history books it's neglected. The material infrastructures, the hardware of our histories. So we learn about economic history, political history, cultural history, but not about the things that populate our world. And these things, or the machines, really matter for history. So yes, it's about hardware. But it's not only about hardware, it's also about software, you might call it. So it's about everything needed to make these machines work. And one of the things that is needed is, in fact, people. Because to work with these machines, you need a lot of knowledge. And this knowledge is embedded, embodied in people. But can also partly be disembodied in books, for example, or in regulations, or in handbooks. So we see technology as a configuration of many elements that need to be in place to make it work. And people are certainly part of this. And then there's yet another element, which is very important, is that we believe that there are choices made. So technological design is not about creating the optimum solution. It's about creating an appropriate solution for a specific context. So there are always choices involved. And so when you say technology, you have to add the notion of choice. And we can go into the exhibitions here. So the website consists of exhibition. Each exhibition consists of tours, and each tours consists of stories. So if we were to go into the Daily Lives exhibition, we can see some of these choices. And again, it's important that when you think about people connected to technology, we do not only think about engineers or experts or companies. Users are very much part of the history of technology and of the lens of technology. Because they work with these technologies and they in fact make them work. So we have an exhibition about daily lives. Then for example, if we were to go to the tour Waste Not, Want Not, and then we go to one specific story. This is the story about pens into planes. It's about the collection of aluminium during the war. So, because during the war, but also in the interwar years, the technological choice was made for nation states to become autarctic. That meant that they didn't want to import goods, but want to substitute them. And this influenced many technological choices. but it also meant a lot of emphasis on recycling and reuse. So this is a picture of during the Second World War. Women were very important here. They became the collectors of waste, and they were the starting point for a process of reuse. And in fact, the recycling in the 70s and 80s was often building on the same tradition. So choices in the past had implications for the future. So this is the choice for recycling and waste. Well, we can go to another exhibition. For example, the media exhibition. Then we can go to, here is a story about a radio bringing, the story is called Bringing Your Living Room Into the World. It's about the transistor radio into the car, and it's about the fact that after the Second World War, cars became connected to the idea of freedom, the idea of the family, promoting family life even inside the car, creating a cozy family home as an extension of the family house. So technology also means that we talk about these choices and the values behind it. So this is about the lens of technology. So, and again, it's important to recall that technology is about people, about knowledge, it's about values, it's about the connection between all these things. So in this website, you will explore some of these connections. And when you think about objects that we show here in this digital museum, what we call contextualize them in this way. We look at the people involved, the choices made in the past, and how these technologies were produced in such a way that the fit was created with the context. Well, the second lens we talk about is the transnational history lens. And to show this, perhaps I go to another exhibition, that's the infrastructure exhibition. And there's a tour on from network to nation state, which basically shows how nation states were appropriating all kind of networks. Because in the 19th century, what we see is the emergence of a host of new networks, telegraphy, electricity networks, railway networks, and all these networks, many of them started as international networks, what we now would call, they were crossing borders. While they were crossing borders, nation states were developing, and these nation states wanted to own the networks or control them. So they were creating borders. So we see two processes. On the one hand, we see technologies crossing borders, and we see nation states trying to control them, to make them national. And this is a perfect example of that kind of dual process, because the Gotthard Railway was designed and developed by several nations, in particular Italy, Germany and Switzerland. So it was a real international project, which was also perceived as a European project because it would connect Northern Europe with Southern Europe. Because there were two railway systems, a Southern railway system and a Northern railway system, disconnected because of the Alps. And the connection would make it possible, the Gotthard tunnel would make it possible to connect both systems. Of course, embedded in this was also a competition between France and Germany, because this would especially give Germany an advantage, this tunnel. So competition between nation states is part of this. But the important thing is this was an European project then, an international project, but the Swiss appropriated it over time as a Swiss project. They nationalized, in a way, the Gotthard Railway and said this is a typical Swiss project. And if you would go to the Verkehrshaus, in Switzerland, you will see that it's seen as a kind of typical Swiss project. It got a national identity. So what this website does, it uncovers the European dimensions of objects that have been nationalized and argues that both are important, in fact. It does not argue that the national one is not important, because after all, this is about transnational history. So it means that the national is there, is very important, but there is an added dimension. It makes clear that there were connections between various objects, and that this is an history which is important for Europe, because it led to the development of European identities and markets and standards. I will talk about it in a minute. We use a number of concepts to talk about these connections. So we use the concept of circulation of people, of products, for example. If we, for example, go back to the Daily Lives exhibition, and then we go to the sewing machine, you see here the first story. This was circulated. The U.S. Singer sewing machine was circulated across Europe, but it was appropriated in very different ways across Europe. So we look at these national and sometimes local appropriations. So we use the notion of circulation and appropriation. We also use the language of linking and de-linking. So if we go back to the infrastructure then we see, for example, the Brotherhood pipeline, which was developed to create connections in Eastern Europe. For example, the Comecon developed a energy network across Eastern Europe, and this was advertised as creating brotherhood. And this is what you often see when the people building these networks create a myth that if you connect people materially, they will also somehow become friends. So if you go by train from the Netherlands to Russia, and because you do that very often, you become more friendly, and then war would be less plausible. So there are larger ideas behind the building of infrastructures, and these larger ideals are also discussed on this website. But inevitably, you link and de-link. So you link certain places, you include certain places and certain people, and you exclude certain places and certain people. So we talk about linking and de-linking. So who's involved, who's not involved, and this will shape Europe. Okay, I've talked about the two lenses, the lens of technology and the lens of transnational history. And let me stress again, technology is not innovation. It's a much broader concept, and transnational is about the crossing of borders, but includes the nation state and includes the national identity, but shows that there are other identities attached to it, added to it, sometimes in competition with it, sometimes not. So what is then the European identity that's explored at this website? Well, first you could say what's explored is the European experience. Because Europe is a peculiar part of the Eurasian continent, where there are many smaller nation states in the same space competing, and many languages. So that creates a specific European experience of crossing borders, which is specific to Europe. On the technological side, this creates the problem of interfacing, because many technologies develop locally, nationally, and then they need to become connected. So Europe is about interfacing. So a typical European identity is the interface identity, which materializes in objects. For example, a specific object, which is an interface object, is the so-called Bern key, visible here. The Bern key is the key to unlock wagons that cross borders in Europe. because there was a very impractical situation that many wagons had their own key in Europe, and because they had their own key, it was hard for them to cross borders because there were too many keys. So they had to come up with one key. This seemed to be easy, but it was not, because you need to change locks. But it's also not easy because the question was which standard would become dominant. The typical solution here was to have a German and French key connected. So this is what we call an interface technology. So you see a separate class of technologies emerging, which are typical Europe. While there are other things that you might call Europe, for example, there are European projects. If you go to Knowledge Society exhibition, you will find many examples of European projects. And for example, the space project was a typical European, because for example, here you see an example of the launcher, and you can see that several parts were constructed by companies in several countries. So this rocket is in fact a combination of national traditions into a new project. So that's typically, we argue, a European project. So Europe is about connecting, interfacing, and therefore it's often fragmented, because there's not one process of interfacing, there are many processes, and you could consider them layers. So perhaps the fragmentation is the core of the European experience, and not the integration. The EU has a logo, unity in diversity, but the unity is a kind of mystical element. So how does the unity emerge out of the diversity? That's unclear. Well, this website, we would like to propose an alternative that's divided we stand to this EU logo. And perhaps it's also important to say that the EU is a very important actor, also visible in the exhibitions in our website here, but we see the EU as a latecomer in the process of building connections. It is one actor. It has become a lot more important towards the end of the 20th century, but it was a latecomer, and it was building on a much larger tradition that emerged since the 19th century. So this larger history of European integration, this is the kind of history we would like to explore with you. So I therefore would like to invite you to join us in exploring this history. Thank you.